Hello and welcome to the 17th in my series of CPD Coffee Times with me, Dr Tina Rae. Today I'm going to focus on supporting us to understand and promote resilience in our children and young people. For those of you who do not know of my work as a teacher, psychologist, author and therapeutic supervisor, just to give you a brief overview, I currently work as a consultant psychologist for Compass Fostering and also support a range of practitioners in developing their therapeutic practice in a range of different contexts, both in education and social services. I'm also a prolific author and I'm very proud of the work, for example, that I have been able to produce for Nurture UK, my favourite charity of choice. And I'm committed to providing evidence-based practical tools and resources for practitioners that are easy to use and really do have an effect in terms of promoting the well-being and mental health of our children and young people. And of course, I have a long and very fruitful association with Hinton House Publishers and the wonderful Sarah Miles. And these are just a selection of some of the resources that I'm going to probably make some reference to today, particularly the Essential Resilience and Wellbeing Toolkit. Some of the resources and ideas are taken directly from that particular publication. So at the outset, I just have to obviously flag up again that I'm recording this in the context of the coronavirus pandemic, which is ongoing and obviously which is causing a huge amount of stress for many of us, both adults and children alike. Some of us have levels of resilience which are enabling us to manage this period reasonably well, whilst others are finding themselves feeling more fragile than they were previously before the lockdown occurred. But in my view, there's never been a time when knowing for us as adults, knowing how to manage our own well-being and how to support our children and young people has been so vital. It's absolutely paramount now that we, as the adults in these relationships, model the kind of resilience and ability to self-soothe and regulate our nervous systems more than ever, I think, so that children actually feel supported in order to do likewise. So in this session, I'm going to primarily focus on arguing as to why I think there is an issue for resilience per se with our children, young people generally today, and this is notwithstanding the current corona pandemic, but also I'm going to highlight some of the ways I think that we can develop the skills that we need and also reinforce the fact that from my perspective, resilience is something that can be taught as part of our wellbeing curriculum, and it can imbue and be embedded within the systems in our education, within our schools. So I think ultimately I'm also going to focus on this notion that we ourselves as adults need our own resilience and mental health, again, if we're going to be able to promote the resilience and mental health of our children and young people effectively. The World Health Organization's definition of mental health, a state of well-being in which the individual realizes his or her own abilities, they can cope with the normal stresses of life and work productively and fruitfully. They're able to make a contribution to their community, and that's the basic definition. So in essence, mental health is the foundation for well-being and effective functioning. And I think what's interesting now, reflecting upon this particular quote, is we're talking about the normal stresses of life. And I have to be very, very clear here, we're not dealing with something normal at this current point in time. So it's very important that we really reflect upon and know how to build our own levels of resilience. Why is it so important? We are very, very conscious, I think, now of the rise in mental health difficulties. This isn't something new. As far back as 2012, the number of prescriptions issued for mental health problems was 46.7 million. That's a huge amount. And we know also that the average onset for depression, the average age onset, is now 14.5 years compared to 29.5 when I was born in 1960. So within my lifetime, within that 60-year period, this is incredible, isn't it? It's jumped right back from 29.5 to 14.5. There's no argument here, in my view, that young people now are experiencing heightened levels of anxiety and depression and emotional disorders. And why is this such a concern? Because we know that mental health problems are associated, a factor in educational failure, family disruption, youth offending and antisocial behaviour. And that places huge demands on our social services, our NHS and on our schools and the youth justice system. We also know that there is growing evidence from the research that some particular types of mental health problems are predictive of negative outcomes generally later on in life. And there is a real distinct correlation now between child and adolescent mental health issues and mental health problems in adults. You're more likely to continue to have a mental health problem in adulthood if you had one as a child. And there's also clearly, and we know this from the research, a direct link between adults who experience high levels of anxiety and mental health problems and their children. It is usually the case, and we know this from the research, that children of parents who have mental health difficulties themselves are far more likely to develop them. And the cost to our services is huge here. It's 10 times higher for those with no significant problems. So I think that that is something that we have to factor into our thinking. This is the rationale for developing our level of support and increasing it for our children and young people now. And of course, we know that the issue of self-harm, and that I have done a whole session on this in this series of CPD coffee time session, so you can reflect back on this, but I think it is important to highlight it here. This is a real concern, because at the top end of the continuum, this is obviously what we want to prevent. Admissions for boys have doubled in the last 2 years, and that is a significant factor now, I think, because people used to think in the days when people did not have the same level of awareness, I think, that there wasn't such an issue, but we're increasingly seeing boys admitted via the emergency services due to their self-harming behaviours. And of course, during this period of lockdown, we know from the Young Minds survey in March this year, 2020, that actually children who had anxiety post-COVID during the lockdown period were reporting greater levels of self-harming behaviours. And we know that they do it to cope with their emotions. We know it gives them a sense of relief. It's a way of managing that psychological pain. But this is hugely concerning, because of course it heightens the suicide risk. And I think also the sense of isolation that many of our children with mental health difficulties have experienced previously has clearly been compounded by this lockdown period. And although access to the internet, to social media, can be a positive in terms of creating support networks for children, young people, particularly when they are more isolated, we must also factor into our thinking that this can also be a cause of real stress and anxiety, and compound issues around body image and levels of anxiety and self-harming behaviours. So this notion of broadcasting yourself, presenting yourself in the best possible light, always being visible on social media, can cause a great deal of stress and additional pressure that children, young people really don't need, particularly at this current moment in time. And I would suggest this is also the same for us as adults. And we need to be very careful here that we're modelling appropriate behaviours in our use of social media, for example. And also checking very much, being very vigilant about ensuring that our children are not accessing self-harm websites that really do trigger their self-harming behaviours. And likewise, also reinforcing notions of perfection around body image as well. So I think the reason I'm flagging all this up is just to highlight the fact that I do think that these are key factors in terms of the erosion of children and young people's resilience. And they certainly would explain some of the reasons, I think, why there has been an increase in mental health difficulties during my lifetime, and certainly in the last 15 to 20 years. Prior to that, we did not have access to this in the same way. And although there was always a sexual objectification of women, for example, I am absolutely clear now that this has increased phenomenally since children are being on the internet all the time, accessing social media. And there is a link clearly between the rise in anorexia and body image problems generally, but also in wanorexia. And this is, I think, Tanya Byron coined this term as far back as 2015. So not quite anorexic, but just want to be, in the sense that they are counting calories every day, trying not to eat more than 400 or 500 calories a day. These are the girls and young women who are really sucked into this way of behaving and put all their energy, hypervigilant energy, into actually trying to maintain this kind of size zero image. And then of course there's bigorexia, which is mainly around the issue of boys who are taking anabolic steroids and pumping up and going to the gym regularly and eating lots of high protein protein foods and juices, etc. And I think, again, this is an issue, this notion of perfection, this notion that you must have this body image. And of course, the results of that can be quite damaging, just simply in terms of, you know, general health. So taking anabolic steroids can cause impotence, it can cause hair loss, thyroid problems, heart attack, stroke, etc. So this is very serious stuff, in essence. And of course, the NSPCC in 2015 also highlighted the issues around pornography that children were accessing online. And many people I've spoken to since this, over the last 7 or so years, have really been kind of really shocked, I think, that children would be accessing this stuff. And I think we have to be very, very much more vigilant, I think, as parents, carers, adults in these relationships, that we really are clear about what is okay and what's not okay to watch. When you've got 12 and 13 year olds who think, 1 in 10 of them, that they're addicted to pornography and that they've made or been part of making a sexually explicit video, this is something that should really concern us. Watching pornography, according to Peter Liver, director of Childline, the children said in their survey that it made them feel depressed, gave them body image problems. They felt pressure to engage in sexual acts that they were not ready for. And of course, the website Pornhub was amongst the top 5 favourite sites for boys aged 11 to 16 in the Childwise survey in 2013-14. And I really would highlight with everyone listening to this today, just think about this. Ask your children, young people, are they accessing this stuff? Because of course it can be extremely damaging in terms of not just presenting perfect bodies to children, which of course are unachievable because they're quite plastic, but also in presenting images of relationships that have nothing to do with consent. So again, the reason I'm flagging this up is to say I do think that there are a huge number of factors that are contributing to the damaging of children's levels of resilience and overall mental health and well-being. Dr. Heather Cleland Woods picked this up, she was working at Glasgow University at the time. When she highlighted the fact that children were getting more anxious and depressed due to this 24-hour demand of social media. So if you want to find some research to support my arguments here, please make reference to this. They measured the sleep quality, self-esteem, anxiety, depression, investment in social media of 467 teenagers. And it was clear from this piece of research, although it was not a huge scale study, but it was clear, very evident, that there was a direct link between these difficulties and increased problems with sleep quality, self-esteem, etc., and investment in social media. And those children or teenagers who were describing themselves as anxious and more vulnerable clearly had a greater investment in social media. This was the kind of anonymous forum that they could engage in and feel that they had some level of acceptance in. So that does also need to raise alarm bells for us. So my argument in this session today is that I really do think we need to prevent this, and there is so much that we can do. We need to ensure that there's early intervention for our children and young people, and we need to build, teach and foster resilience. So we know, have things, all of us human beings have things that we need to overcome in our lives. Life will throw lots of things at us, different difficulties and problems and events, losses, bereavements, etc., etc., not getting the job we want, not being successful in a way that we might want to. And quite often we do fail at things. It's a normal thing. We fail. We fail a test, we have illnesses, accidents, we fall out with other people, we have particular setbacks and many challenges. We certainly have many of those at the moment. So this begs the question about resilience. Why is it that some people, like Mr. Jobs in his lifetime, was able to bounce back frequently again and again, whilst other people like Britney Spears seem to crumble? And I think this is a real issue to kind of think about. What is it about these individuals? What actually caused this young person not to be able to manage and cope? And this is where I think, you know, you need to stop and reflect and think, well, what is it about her context? A bit like Amy Winehouse, who was there supporting her, who was nurturing her, who was providing the right kind of feedback, the right kind of challenge? And there's an awful lot that we as adults need to be thinking about we can do in order to support the effective development of resilience in our children, young people. There are some people, obviously, like Mariu van Rijn, the gold women's 2000 metres champion, who really do humble us, because we'll look at them and we'll think, what is it about them? Is there something that they have inside them, this innate resilience? Is it something genetic? Is it something fostered in the social context? The term resilience comes from this Latin word resilio, which in essence means to jump back, which is why I always have a Tigger image at the end of this presentation. Because I do love it, thinking this notion about being able to just keep bouncing back. And Cyrulnik talked about resilience as being about abandoning the imprint of the past. So as a positive psychologist, I find this an incredibly hopeful message, and I really do believe it to be true. We all have the capacity and the opportunity or the potential to be able to say, my past does not have to dictate my future. And it's a hugely powerful message to give to our children and young people. We can move forward, we can gain strength, we can learn resilience. What we need to understand is that resilience itself is a dynamic process. It occurs in a context. It's a result of us, according to Rutter, interacting with our own environment. So with the people, with the context in which we find ourselves. So I think it's a two-pronged thing here. There are elements of resilience that if we're born, I call it the happiness gene. If we are born as happy bunnies, we will have an element of that. We know that there's a difference. We know that there's something genetic, but also we know that it can be fostered and built upon within the context of our situation that we find ourselves in our environment. We will have key adults who nurture us, who show us unconditional regard. And these really are essentially the people who can foster that well-being and nurture our resilience, notwithstanding any kind of difficulties or traumas we may have experienced in our past lives. So we know that it's a construct, but I would use this bounce back ability. It's my construct here about getting up, dusting down, starting all over again. I think sometimes if I asked you to define it, you might want to come up with something different. And it's really difficult. Many people will say, we think we know what it is until we actually try to define it. So it might be something you want to do at this point in the presentation, is just to pause and think about how would you define this concept for yourselves. My argument essentially here is that we need to create for our children and young people this resilience toolbox. For practitioners, for us as professionals or parents, to foster, build and maintain resilient, well-balanced, optimistic and mentally healthy children and young people. And I think this has never been more important, that we teach children a well-being curriculum that fosters resilience, the ability to be grounded, to self-soothe their nervous systems, to manage anxiety and stress, to recognise that there's an awful lot they can use in terms of tools from positive psychology, mindfulness, cognitive behaviour therapy, etc. All of these things, clearly, I have actually made sessions in this series of CPD Coffee Time sessions, because I think that they are all essential elements of a child or young person's resilience toolbox or toolbox of resilience. And I think we have a duty of care to ensure that our own toolbox has the appropriate tools for ourselves if we're going to effectively model resilience to our children and young people. And it's particularly pertinent and important at a time when there is a lack of external support for our children and young people. And I'm sure that, you know, the government will be thinking now with our National Health Service, with our psychological services, about the need for addressing some of the mental health problems which are going to be coming out, I think, in the next few months, primarily when children go back to school in September. But I think this is not going to be a magic pill here, and it certainly won't be enough to actually ensure that all our children have the right kind of approach and support that they need therapeutically. So it is essential. We've got to actually skill ourselves up at this point in time. So let's think a bit more about why it's becoming harder for our young people to bounce back after setbacks, because I do think this is true. We know that since the time of the Greeks, human beings have been able to distinguish between what we would call normal sadness or suffering and clinical depression. And since the development of the DSM, now DSM-5, the classification system for mental illness, this boundary has become blurred. But the only context that manual takes into account for depression is bereavement. So we need to factor this into our thinking. This is because it can have an impact on us in our wider society. People can suffer similar symptoms to depression in reaction to many life events. So when things go wrong, they fail an exam, etc. This is actually normal. Of course it's normal. It's not pathological. And the symptoms don't always last for that long. But there is a tendency for us to medicalize this misery and pathologize it. So very, very important. Major clinical depression usually arises for no reason. You wake up and you feel like you have, as my mum used to say, this kind of black dog here somewhere. And I think that context usually can't explain it. So I think we may be creating a problem of resilience by pathologizing normal reactions to life experiences. So very important this to factor in to the way that we approach the development of our children's resilience here. So why is it becoming harder for our young people to bounce back after setbacks? And I'm going to give you 10 big reasons to explain the erosion of young people's resilience now. The first one is this. Number one, treating young people like infants. So our society thinking that young people need constant protection, can't handle responsibility, they're not capable thinking, so they're moody, they're selfish. And some people who do my kind of work as a psychologist think that there's something wrong with their brain. Research shows us very clearly that treating young people like infants makes them behave like infants. Just the same way, the message that we give our young people is absolutely essential. If you treat someone in a bad way, if you label them in a way that is detrimental to their well-being, self-esteem, you call them stupid, mad, ugly, horrible, nasty, unlovable, etc. This is innocence, is what you're going to get back. And also this notion of spotlight on the individual, this undermines resilience, this focus so much on ourselves and how we feel. And although I am a great believer in being emotionally literate, being aware of my feelings and those of others, this is not the same as being self-obsessed, because what this does is it encourages young people to think that they're the centre of the world, which is fine when you're 2 years of age. You should be, you need to be. There are lots of things that you need to be protected from. But what this does do essentially is it fosters this notion that you kind of blow everything out of proportion. If anything goes wrong, it's like a huge, huge issue for you. And then, of course, number three, black and white thinking. Our culture does view people as fixed entities, which are unchangeable. So you're either a good person, a bad one, you're smart, you're clever, you're stupid. And again, what does this do? It's totally exaggerates the significance of failure and difficulties. These labels, not helpful at all. And then there's this notion, number four, of entitlement. So I want everything now. I'm entitled to this. It's my right. And celebrity culture has a lot to answer for here, in my view, suggesting that success needs to be instant. People think that then hard work and effort are not important. I just need to go on Celebrity Big Brother or whatever show it is, and I can suddenly become very, very famous. I don't actually have to work at it. I don't have to engage in that four-letter word, which is probably one of my favourite words in the universe, because I think work, a bit like being kind, is an absolute essential if we're going to lead meaningful lives. What does this do? It increases self-obsession and ultimately undermines resilience. And wrapping up in cotton wool, this also undermines resilience. And I'm very conscious of the COVID pandemic in the background here and the need to ensure our children are safe. So I'm not actually factoring that in essence, because that is clear. That's not the same as wrapping up in cotton wool when we don't want our children to have any negative experiences. So I don't want her to get upset she didn't get the part in the school play. I don't want her to struggle with her work, etc. And this is really, really difficult, because actually not kind of encountering these difficulties doesn't build resilience. Of course it doesn't. We don't actually develop the skills we need in order to be able to cope with the knocks and blows that we receive. And again, psychological cleanliness. I worked with a colleague many, many years ago, probably about 30 years ago now, who was very clear that she did not argue with anyone in her household. If people disagreed, they would just leave the room and quietly go away. It was almost very pristine psychologically. And I was quite shocked about this. And I couldn't understand then how you knew how to have a good argument, how you knew how to make up, how you knew how to kind of cope with conflict if you didn't ever experience it. So I think this is really, really important. Resilience is formed as a result of dealing with that kind of setback. And also negative emotions, or uncomfortable emotions, I might say now, but negative emotions are wrong. Of course they're not. People are frightened of them, though. And what do? They suppress them then. They don't show them. They think that it's wrong to show that you're angry, you're upset, you're hurt, you're distressed. And paradoxically, what does that do? If we suppress them, then that causes more of those negative emotions that we don't actually want. Number eight, ignoring the importance of bad feelings. Again, people think that bad feelings don't have a purpose, that things like guilt, shame, frustration, they're only negative. Research shows us that actually the reverse is true. Bad feelings can galvanize us to do things differently. We need them to succeed. I should, for example, feel shame, and I should feel guilty and angry and upset with myself if I've done something wrong, if I've hurt a friend, if I've told a lie, if I've taken credit for someone else's work, if I've actually dissed a friend incorrectly, if I've stolen, if I've done something wrong. This is really important that we actually know that we can then go and we can make up, we can sort things out. It galvanizes us to actually change our behavior. And the need to be perfect definitely does undermine resilience. And social media, mass media has an awful lot to answer for here. It makes us believe that we have to be perfect. And these messages for children, young people who are still forming their sense of self are hugely, hugely powerful. And what does this do? It makes us feel inadequate because it exaggerates our inevitable problems and difficulties, our lack of perfection. And it undermines resilience because we see that the perfection is not attainable. So this comparing ourselves to others is hugely unhelpful and really does undermine resilience. And having too much choice also undermines resilience. We've got more choice than ever. Paradoxically, it makes people not choose, regret our choices, feel depressed or simply overwhelmed. So all of these factors, in my view, undermine young people's ability to bounce back. But I would argue very strongly that our young people, children, young people, are not fragile. They're not fragile. Children who've experienced extreme trauma in their early years, that's a different. They're at the top end of the continuum, but the majority of us are not fragile. And I can honestly say, from many, many years of working with the most vulnerable children, I am always still astonished, sometimes overwhelmed, and quite joyful about the fact that many of them have this Tigger quality and do and are able to bounce back given the right kind of support and nurture and love and unconditional regard. I can liken them to springs or balls. They can bounce back. And I think most human beings can bounce back psychologically after being knocked out of shape, just like in nature. And it's that ability to cope with adversity or hardship. And we need to be able to do this. This is what builds our resilience. We can carry on and even flourish, in the words of Martin Seligman, after setbacks. And many people that I'm talking to at the moment are talking about ways in which they have been able to flourish during this lockdown period, which is a really hopeful, optimistic message for me. So key attributes of resilient children and young people and their ability to connect with others. These are the kids who really are able to make those links socially. They have the social and emotional competence necessary to do that. They are free from excessive anxiety. And note, I say excessive. This is really important. We all experience anxiety. It is normal. We all experience a level of stress. It is normal. But excessive anxiety is not. But they're free from that. They can communicate their needs. They can talk about their feelings. This is really important. They can engage also in meaningful activity and regular experience of flow, which I made reference to in the positive psychology session. I'm going to do another session on that next, which focuses primarily on creativity and flow, because I think it's so important, particularly at this time and given that we're going into the summer holiday period when we need to encourage that. Resilient kids also have this sense of control and a growth mindset. I can't do it yet. I can learn from my mistakes, and also a sense of purpose and meaning. There's a reason why we're here. There's a reason and there's a purpose for me being here and for my life and for my existence. So this also, continuing, key factors, key attributes, their self-esteem is good. They are optimistic. They see the good in things. Their glass is half full, not half empty. They focus outwards on other people and what's happening out there in the world. They live in the present and they look to the future. They're not looking back to the past, thinking about how awful things were or have been. A sense of humour is key to this as well, and I value humour more than anything in my life, actually, apart from kindness and hard work. Playfulness and freedom oddly enough, from excessive materialism doesn't really matter that much. So building resilience for us in terms of building it with our children, within our children, young people, involves what I call a two-pronged approach. Having the personal coping skills, they need those, these are essential to manage everyday stressors. And these can be taught, and we are the ones that can teach it. And also environmental factors. We can change things within the environment for our children, young people, to make it more resilience friendly, okay, so that we can foster that resilience more effectively. And Carol Revich in 2007 identified these seven learnable skills of resilience. And these, in essence, are what I would be arguing should form part and parcel of our resilience wellbeing curriculum within our school context. So we need to be teaching emotional awareness or regulation, how to control our impulses, how to maintain an optimistic bias, how to understand the links between what we do and what will happen next. So causal analysis, if I do this, then this will happen, i.e. that gives me the opportunity to take a personal responsibility for my actions. Empathy for others. Self-efficacy, so that level of being controlling of myself and my emotions and coping with the situation I find myself with, and then reaching out, connecting with and reaching out and supporting other people in my social context, in my community. And all of these can, in my view, be taught. And in order to be able to develop this curriculum and ensure that these seven key factors are included within it, we have to understand how, as adults, we can help young people to bounce back. And there are 11 specific things I think we should factor into our thoughts and behaviour now. Number one is holding high expectations. We need to think that young people are actually capable. We need to give them the right kind of challenge appropriate to their level of ability, clearly. But we need to expect them that they're going to achieve their goals. And also understand that they reach them at different times, but most of us, we're going to get there. We need to ensure that we are focusing away from ourselves. So this self-obsession needs to actually be reduced. So it's important we don't make the child the centre of the universe. It undermines their well-being, it exaggerates every minor incident. So we need to encourage them to go out there and think about what other people need, to be kind, to show that, to develop their levels of empathy. It shouldn't all be about me, me, me. That's fine when you're two because you need that level of nurture and attention, but not when you're 22, when you're 12, etc. We need to factor into our thinking that people are not born smart. Okay, we need to move away from this. It's a real seismic shift for some to think that people are not actually born smart. Okay, intelligence and ability is something that we need to work at. So this makes reference back to growth mindset. All the most successful people in life will have to have had overcome failures. And we need to use role models to illustrate this to our children and young people. There are many, many people who have experienced significant difficulties and they've overcome them and become successful. Let's model that for them. And let's also teach children that failure often leads to success. Let's factor this into our thinking in order to promote their levels of resilience. Failure is a learning opportunity. Let's get this in our heads. What have you learned from that? What would you do differently next time? And let's talk to them about failures we might have overcome, not on too deep or personal a level. I have to be very careful here because I really don't like the culture of people actually disclosing too much personal stuff. I actually think that there's a kind of boundary that you don't go across because that's not safe for kids. But we need to actually think about how we can be a role model and talk about things that we found difficult, particularly academically, and how we managed to get over that. Or think about things that we've been worried about and anxieties we may have had, and how we manage them, what we did in order to overcome them. And also normalize, don't personalize. So it's very common for kids to think that this type of thing only happens to them when they've had something really bad happen to them. Oh, you know, no one else experiences, no one knows what I'm feeling, no one understands this, it's only me that's feeling this bad, etc. We need to encourage them to view the setbacks they experience as normal. Everyone experiences them, and not think that it's just something that reflects badly on them. So we need to normalize it. It's okay, we all experience this kind of thing. We can all get through it. And this thing about bad feelings being normal is really, really important. Bad or uncomfortable feelings, they're normal, it's fine. It's human nature to experience negative emotions. Only psychopaths and dead people don't. That is a joke, by the way. Bad feelings, they're normal. Uncomfortable feelings, they're normal. They're part of our human experience on a daily basis. And learning anything worthwhile requires some level of frustration. I've watched little ones learning to read and getting really upset and keyed up, etc., etc. And I think sometimes what we need to be thinking is that that's part of the learning process. The emotional labour of learning mustn't be underestimated. We can't protect children from that. What we can do is prevent that from becoming an issue. We can teach them how to manage the emotional anxiety that they might experience when they're learning something new, how to use self-soothing, grounding, how to factor into their thinking, what will I need to do first, second, third. So using some problem solving, doing some deep breathing, recognizing that, yeah, it's okay, you do feel like this, it's normal to get frustrated when you're learning something new, etc. And I think that's really, really important message, and we need to factor that into our thinking, absolutely. Bad feelings don't last. We need to factor this in too. When young people are encountering negative things, and I'm particularly thinking of teenagers as well, they always think that this is going to last forever and ever. I'm always going to feel this bad. I've just split up with my boyfriend. I'm never going to be happy again. It's awful, awful, awful. We know that research has shown us that bad feelings generally, in the main, they don't last. Bereavement's a different kettle of fish, of course, but we need to remind young people that these feelings will pass, it will go away. We're not patronising them, we're not underestimating the fact that it's painful at this moment in time. We're actually affirming that with them, we're recognising it, we're helping them to engage in self-soothing. But we also need to really prompt them to think that actually this won't be forever. And not worrying or overprotecting our kids, notwithstanding this current pandemic, I think this is absolutely essential. We know that life is full of ups and downs. If we try and cotton wool and protect kids too much, then when they meet a setback or when they have a challenge and they've got to assess risk, they won't be able to do it effectively. We need to allow them to make their own mistakes and learn from them. Growth mindset. I can't do it yet. I've made a mistake. I am not going to catastrophize and get overwrought by it. I'm going to think, stop, reflect on this. What went wrong? Why did it go wrong? What could I do differently? And what could other people perhaps do, and also to support me to be more effective next time? Overprotection. Not allowing kids to make mistakes, not allowing young people to see that they can learn from them, really just makes them more vulnerable, more anxious, and ultimately undermines their ability to develop a level of appropriate resilience. And an essential, number 9, perfection does not exist. There is no such thing. Everyone, doesn't matter how accomplished or brilliant they may seem to be, will have some flaw at some point. There's no standard for perfection. It's much, much more important that we try to do our best rather than be the best. This is really, really important. I think from my perspective, always the mantra that I've maintained for throughout my teen years, right the way through now to now, is that actually all I can do is try to be the best that I can be. And that does not equate to perfection. There's no such thing as a perfect parent, a perfect psychologist, teacher, mother, father, whatever. There is no such thing. All we can do is try to be the best that we can be. And also, number 10, what we can do. We need to factor this into our thinking, that we can teach young people skills. They've got this inbuilt need to learn. It's part of being a little human being. And we know that we can help them to learn the skills they need to actually manage in life. And we teach them in school the academics, the stuff that everyone is so worried that they're getting behind in because of this pandemic. Actually, we can also teach them how to manage the emotional labour of learning, how to manage the stresses and the difficulties that they experience on a daily basis. And we can role model this behaviour for them. And I think it's really, really important that we factor this into our thinking, particularly now when I think there's never been more of a need for a well-being curriculum to take precedence in terms of ensuring the safety and nurture of our young children as they transition back to school this September. And finally, what we need to factor into our thinking is that one size does not fit all. There's a continuum. Not all children are going to respond to one way of building resilience, just like they're not all going to respond to mindfulness or CBT approaches or any other therapeutic approach. We need to think of very, very clearly that there are going to be many different ways for children to bounce back. And this is where, as professionals, as carers, as those who nurture and love our young people, we need to be very clear that we need to have an effective toolbox that can differentiate as appropriate to each individual. So what next when support has gone in terms of therapeutic interventions for our children and young people, or it's very thin on the ground in our schools, our budgets are tight, and we don't actually have as much access to bespoke mental health support and interventions or the psychologists that we need? I think we need to be very clear that we need to develop in-house skills here. We need to ensure that our mental health leads, that our members of our team, the pastoral team, have the right kind of training and support. But we also need to really factor into our thinking that it is really possible now to train up people in-house to actually deliver the kind of support that some of our children, young people will need. Staff competence and confidence is essential here. It's not about making everyone a therapist, but it's about ensuring that they feel confident and competent in order to interact more therapeutically with our children, young people. So when I say grow your own, I think this is really now about actually factoring into our thinking that we need to identify people in our school communities who could take on the role of nurturing and supporting and being that key worker for some of our more vulnerable, less resilient children and young people. We need to continue, obviously, to tackle the stigma around mental health and build what I call a resilient staff team who can effectively model the behaviours that we need in order to remain resilient and to maintain that and to develop that within our children and young people. So it's important to perhaps just stop and reflect for a few moments and maybe just take some time if you're doing this on your own or if you're doing it with peers or friends. I think really, really important that we think about ourselves as the ones now who are doing the nurturing, we're looking after the kids and we're doing the resilience building. How do we do that, particularly in this current context when stress levels, anxiety levels are much increased? How do we maintain our well-being and mental health? What is it that we do? And think back maybe to the positive psychology session that I delivered as part of these CPD coffee time sessions. But how do we build and further develop our own resilience? What are the key elements that we are using in order to do this? What are the tools that we're using? What are the strategies? What are the systems that we have in place? And how do we model this to our children and young people in terms of our behaviours, our interactions with them? Who is supporting us? What are the systems for support in terms of us maintaining our resilience and in terms of us fostering it in our children, young people? What peer group supervision systems do you have? What immediate social network of support do you have in order to continue to do this? There are issues around supervision and supportive structures that maybe it's a good thing to think about at this juncture, particularly as we will be going back into schools in a very different climate for many of us. And after a period of reflection, a period in which many of us may have felt more vulnerable and lacking in a sense of autonomy. So very important questions to begin to think about now. So I'm going to unashamedly promote this wellbeing toolkit for mental health leads again at this point, because I do think if we're talking about resilience, understanding it, developing it, maintaining it and fostering it in our children, young people, we need to think about our staff teams. And this resource is hugely comprehensive, 20 modules of support for the mental health lead to use in terms of promoting staff wellbeing, awareness, understanding of therapeutic concepts and interventions, and also in terms of ensuring their real understanding of mental health difficulties, the impact of bereavement, for example, grief and loss, attachment issues around trauma, and ways in which they can manage themselves within the school context in order to promote resilience for children and young people. So really, really important that there needs to be something comprehensive that's going on now as we go back into school. This kind of CPD is essential, and many schools staff teams, the budget will be very, very limited. So this is something that I would really highly recommend that you consider. So a key reminder at this point, coming towards the end of the presentation here, The two R's for adults, I call this, and I'm just promoting this essential resilience and wellbeing toolkit for early years here, because much of what I've said today in this presentation is incorporated in this particular resource. It's very, very comprehensive. So anything around growth mindset, nurturing our children, attachment, etc., you will find the key tools and strategies. And this is for professionals and parents. But all of us as adults, a key reminder here is around these two R's. And this is a direct quote from me. As adults, we are the ones who need to model behaviours to children and young people. And that means that we have to be resilient and regulated ourselves, which is not always an easy thing to accomplish, but an essential if we're to truly nurture their well-being. So the need for us to be resilient and regulated ourselves. So let's stop and think about how we start thinking about ourselves now in a deeper level, I think. And this is not self-obsession, and this is certainly not selfishness. It's absolutely essential. As adults, we need to have these two R's developed for ourselves. We need to be resilient and regulated. So 10 top tips, finally, building resilience in ourselves, well-being, maintaining that, an absolute essential. How do we do it? Very, very key to resilience. We're building positive beliefs in our abilities. We remind ourselves of our strengths. Okay, this is not boastful, but what we don't do is compare ourselves to others or this notion of perfection. Very, very important. That just makes us miserable. It's the royal route to misery and suffering, I think. And also finding a sense of purpose in our lives. Let's do things for others. This has been a real positive that's come out of this pandemic. The fact that many of us now are doing so much more out there in our communities and being good, doing good, being kind. What does it do? Doing good produces more good stuff. Being kind produces more kindness. If we do good, we feel good. Developing that strong social network of people who don't push you down, they pull you up. Very, very important for children and for us. And also learning how to adapt and thrive, embracing change. Things are changing all the time at the moment. And very often psychologists talk about how difficult change is, but I think now we've got to embrace it. Very, very important. Learning how to adapt and thrive. Human beings have survived because we've learned how to adapt. We've learned how to be flexible. We also need to be optimistic and really know and understand that setbacks can be learned for. And even when the worst happens, such as now, we've got to be hopeful. We know that we can get through this. We know that we can move forward. And I really firmly believe that we need to factor this into our thinking. We need to give this clear message to our kids too, that this is what we believe. And also nurturing ourselves in the right way, doing the stuff that we know is good for us, the good diet, the exercise, being out in nature, connecting with other people, experiencing flow on a daily basis. Nurturing ourselves in the right way is an essential. And developing our problem-solving skills and maintaining this growth mindset is also key to maintaining and developing resilience for us and for our kids. So setting those goals that are realistic and helping children to do this is important. Breaking them down into manageable chunks so we solve the problems gradually, step by step. And each time we do that little bit of good and we've got that bit better, we've got that one level up on our anxiety ladders, we give ourselves some praise. We recognise that. We affirm that. But, you know, other than, you know, if we don't do this and we make our targets, our problems so great, our targets to solve those problems so great that we will get disheartened. And we need to make sure that we don't get discouraged by the amount of work that still needs to be done, what we need to do in order to achieve our goals. So ultimately, we need to keep working on our skills. So in order to maintain and develop our resilience, to build our resilience, to be happier on a daily basis. And I do believe that's a real key objective for us as human beings. Not to be happy all the time, that's impossible and it's not right. But to be happier is a real journey. This is something that we carry on doing. It's a lifelong learning approach that we need to take here in terms of developing resilience and increasing our happiness. So some final questions to you at the end of this CPD Coffee Time session. Does your approach, context and your parenting style build this resiliency in your children and young people? So think about this as a professional, as a parent, as a carer. What does your approach enable you to do? What does your context that you have created enable you to do? And what does your parenting style enable you to do in terms of building this resiliency? What needs to happen next? What do you need to do in order to increase this? How can you develop your approaches in order to further develop resilience in your children and Please factor this in and in yourself. Can you develop your support systems to truly meet needs? So that notion of differentiation here, very, very clear. How can you do that? So do spend some time as a takeaway thinking about these particular questions. And don't forget the Tigger effect. I've got wonderful Andy Murray here. Had to bounce back again and again and again. And what an example of resilience. I love him. So like Andy, please, please, please just keep this in your minds as we finish this particular CPD session today. It's really important. Keep hopeful. Keep connected. Keep self-regulated. Keep moving physically and mentally. So, you know, really challenging your negative thinking patterns, and ultimately keep bouncing back. And thank you very much for listening today. And I really, really hope that this has been a useful session. And, you know, at the start of these summer holidays, I think really, really important to try and spend some time reflecting on our own well-being and thinking about how we can build our resilience still further, because clearly this is something that we're going to need as we continue to navigate the current situation. So thanks again, and hope you join me for the next CPD Coffee Time session.